cords of death had tangled me, the grip of the grave took hold of me. I came to grief and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray you, save my life. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Thank you. Now on that day, two of the disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures." As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of the Lord. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only you have been and saved.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the ways of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving God among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the Lord be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
Sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith, that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, so that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you, for the honor of your name. Amen. You can try anything. You can doll up your living room like Martha Stewart. You can fix up your backyard and your deck in a way that would be the envy of the photographers or Architectural Digest. But it doesn't matter. people gather at a house, and I do recognize that's a sore point at this particular moment, they always seem to convene in the same room. The kitchen. It's as if there's a gravitational pull toward that place where food is prepared and informally shared. Now, I don't believe that that's either an accidental or even a modern phenomenon. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. Just picture it for a moment. Just days earlier, two of Jesus' disciples, two individuals who knew him intimately as their teacher and Lord, two who had almost certainly heard him prophesy his death and resurrection, had likely witnessed his crucifixion and burial. And now they're walking along the dusty road from Jerusalem to the town of Emmaus. That very same teacher and Lord comes walking along beside them, but they don't know that it's him. The hour is late, so when they reach their destination, they press him to stay with them, and he does. They sit down for a meal, and then, suddenly, they know. It's him. God incarnate in human form, risen from the dead, no less, is sitting right there at the table with them. Now, in last week's sermon, I suggested that we take note of the fact that we, as a human race, have shown through our response to the COVID-19 pandemic an incredible willingness to make rapid and radical changes in our rhythm of life when we're adequately motivated. And I further encourage us to ponder the fact that COVID-19 is hardly the only, and arguably not even the most pressing, reason for which such robust action is advisable. This week, I want to explore more specifically how we might take action around some of the other significant threats to our health and safety. Perhaps today's gospel contains more than initially meets the eye. Perhaps it's all about breaking bread. Perhaps it's all about the food that we share. At first blush, the fact that it is in a moment of breaking bread that Jesus is revealed to these two disciples seems simply to underscore the importance of the Eucharist. And in a way, this is indeed the core truth of this beautiful gospel passage. It is indeed the case that in the moment of breaking the consecrated bread, the Lord is made especially manifest to us. But encountering the risen Christ in breaking bread is a matter that goes far deeper than just someone with a collar saying prayers over some wafers and some wine and then distributing them. On a spiritual level, St. Paul admonishes the church in Corinth that those who receive the elements of communion without presence of God in the act of making Eucharist with our sisters and brothers in faith is a sign of great spiritual blindness. Now, this could be a sermon all on its own, and one day I believe we should explore it. But it's not the main thrust of today's message. Today, I want to explore it a little more on the material level. I want us to look at the actual bread. I'm beginning to wonder if, in light of both Scripture and current reality, we've placed way too little emphasis on the actual bread that we break and how it makes its way to the table. There's a reason that the elements of communion are bread and wine, as opposed to something else. Both of these consumables have a multifaceted quality to them. They both require a certain fruit of the earth, wheat in the case of the bread, and grapes in the case of the wine, to be combined with a significant amount of time and human labor. The bread must leaven and bake, and the wine must ferment. Without this perfect combination of earth's fruits, human labor, and God's time, we do not get the proper elements of Holy Communion. And perhaps we thus do not get the fullness of the experience of breaking bread, suddenly to find our eyes opened and to perceive the risen Lord in our very midst. So let's suppose for a moment that we go back to a pre-industrial way of getting these elements of communion to our table. We grow our own heirloom wheat, grind the berries, add some yeast and liquids to the mix, let it rise, and then bake it ourselves. Likewise, we grow our own varietal grapes, press them, add a little yeast, and then let an oak barrel in plenteous time work its magic until we have a lovely aromatic wine. What effects might that have? Far more than you might imagine. It's been commented by some epidemiologists in recent days that if the Black Plague had hit Europe at a time when the average person's immune system were in the shape that most modern Westerner systems are in today, it would have wiped out nearly the entirety of the population, as opposed to one-third, which was plenty bad enough. Our immune systems are not stronger, but weaker than those of the generations that preceded us. Were it not for chemical treatments that are remarkably good at keeping us alive, not thriving, but alive, for years while we cope with chronic diseases, our life expectancy would be lower than that of our parents and grandparents. The current generation of youngsters may be the first in modern history to have a life expectancy shorter than that the previous generation. And these phenomena are quite easily traceable to a single source: the things that go into our bodies, most notably our food. In our age of industrialized agriculture, we've distanced ourselves tremendously from the sourcing of our food. What we've gained in efficiency and convenience by doing this, we've lost in nutritional value tense. We have managed to disrupt the balance of beneficial microorganisms in our food and in our environment so that we are more defenseless than ever against the harmful ones. Roundup and Clorox may entice us by appearing to eliminate some acute threats in the short run, but in the long run, they are literally killing us from the inside out. Friends, I would argue that the problems resulting from what I have just presented, everything from growing global food insecurity, to rampant chronic disease, to climate change, are on a completely different order of magnitude from the threat for which our world has gone into an unprecedented shutdown these past several weeks. If left unchecked, these trends could literally wipe out the human race. Now you might question what this has to do with a sermon preached in church, and I acknowledge deeply that in the words of St. Paul, if it is for this life alone that we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Yes, our faith does admonish us to set our sights firmly on the world that is to come. And nonetheless, God tells us that there is yet a vision for the world that is. And I believe we could do better. If we are going to be a community that seeks to encounter the risen Christ in the breaking of bread, and to make him known to the world around us, I would encourage us to have a long, hard look at the bread that we break. What's in our food and where it comes from matters. What's in the food we share with others and how that system of growing and sharing works matters. And the good news is that we have power. What food we choose to buy and consume has a massive effect, not only on our own personal health, but upon the health of our economy and our planet. Our choices in what food we distribute to those who lack the means to provide enough food for themselves can truly restore health and vitality to an entire community. Our choices around how we use the land attached to our homes and our churches can make the difference between a world that lives and a world that dies. We've shown in these last few weeks that we know how to make hard choices when we need to. Now let's take that knowledge and allow it to empower us to do what needs doing. Risen Lord, be known to us in the breaking of the bread. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray to our risen Lord, saying, Risen Lord, hear our prayer. O Christ, we stand in awe of your victory over death. Give to us a due reverence for your power of your resurrection, and use us as instruments for that power to be made manifest in all the world. Spread your resurrection power, especially today, throughout the Anglican Communion, Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, in the Episcopal Church of Jerusalem and the Middle East. Pour out your Spirit also upon the Episcopal Church and in this land and our diocese, including Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark, our bishop, and the Church of the Redeemer in San Miguel. Let your blessing also come to our fellow faith assemblies in this community, especially Cornerstone Fellowship. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. O God, in whom mercy and justice embrace, we ask for your love to take wings in all the nations and peoples of the world. Bend the hearts of all nations and peoples toward peace and righteousness. Send your Spirit especially upon Donald, our President, Gavin, our Governor, John, our Mayor, and all those who serve in legislative assemblies or judicial roles in this and every land. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. O great physician and healer, in this time of pandemic and the fear and uncertainty that surround it, we lift up to you all those who care for the sick and the suffering. Pour out a special blessing upon all who follow your call to care for others in body, mind, and spirit, especially. Brad O. and Brad S. Give them the gifts of courage and joy in their work and protect them from all adversity and harm. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, this congregation gathers together as a people made clean and whole by your grace and desiring to know ever more deeply the power of your resurrection. Bless all its members with the gifts of hope, wisdom, and compassion. Pour out a special blessing upon these members in our weekly cycle of prayer. Dave and Christy R., Marie R., Jacob S., Jesse M., and Ernie S., as well as those in military service, Aaron B., Joey E., Abigail M., Valerie M., Amber R., Christopher W., and Taylor W. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. We pray also for all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those who have requested our prayers for healing and wholeness. Abe, Alice, Olivia, Amber, Anna Marie, Ashley, Audrey, Becky, Betty, Diana, Donna, Dorothy, Estefan, Glennis, Janice, Jason, Jebby, Jerry, John, Justin, Kay, Marge, Marie, Marilyn, Mary Beth, Maureen, Naomi, Nina, Rachel, Robert, Ruth, Sally, Sharon, Steve, Tina, and Tom. Give to your people the gifts of comfort and healing, as well as a lively and abiding faith in your goodness throughout all circumstances. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Lord Christ, in your passion and resurrection, you made death the gateway to new and eternal life. Pour that life upon all your servants departed in this life, as especially Frank, Mike W., and Robert B., and raise them to the everlasting glory in your kingdom. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. And now, O Christ, in eager anticipation of your coming kingdom, we pray to you with hearts and voices of our other needs and concerns. We offer you thanks for the blessings in this life.
You will be in the midst of it.